Penguin Random House Audio presents The Art of War by Sun Tzu, translated by Thomas Cleary, read by Lloyd James.
Translator's Preface. The Art of War, compiled well over 2,000 years ago by a mysterious Chinese warrior philosopher, is still perhaps the most prestigious and influential book of strategy in the world today. As eagerly studied in Asia by modern politicians and executives as it has been by military leaders and strategists for the last 2 millennia and more. In Japan, which was transformed directly from a feudal culture into a corporate culture virtually overnight, contemporary students of the art of war have applied the strategy of this ancient classic to modern politics and business with similar alacrity. Indeed, some see in the successes of post-war Japan an illustration of Sun Tzu's dictum of the classic, "To win without fighting is best." As a study of the anatomy of organizations in conflict, the art of war applies to competition and conflict in general, on every level from the interpersonal to the international. Its aim is invincibility, victory without battle, and unassailable strength through understanding of the physics, politics, and psychology of conflict. This translation of The Art of War presents the classic from the point of view of its background in the great spiritual tradition of Taoism. What is perhaps most characteristically Taoist about The Art of War in such a way as to recommend itself to the modern day is the manner in which power is continually tempered by a profound undercurrent of humanism. The Art of War is thus not only a book of war, but also of peace. Above all, a tool for understanding the very roots of conflict and resolution. Translator's Introduction. According to an old story, a lord of ancient China once asked his physician, a member of a family of healers, which of them was the most skilled in the art. The physician, whose reputation was such that his name became synonymous with medical science in China, replied, "My eldest brother sees the spirit of sickness and removes it before it takes shape, so his name does not get out of the house. My elder brother cures sickness when it is still extremely minute, so his name does not get out of the neighborhood. As for me, I puncture veins, prescribe potions, and massage skin, so from time to time my name gets out and is heard among the lords." Among the tales of ancient China, none captures more beautifully than this the essence of the art of war, the premier classic of the science of strategy in conflict. The healing arts and the martial arts may be a world apart in ordinary usage, but they are parallel in several senses. In recognizing, as the story says, that the less needed the better, in the sense that both involve strategy in dealing with disharmony, and in the sense that in both, knowledge of the problem is key to the solution. As in the story of the ancient healers, in Sun Tzu's philosophy, the peak efficiency of knowledge and strategy is to make conflict altogether unnecessary. And, like the story of the healers, Sun Tzu explains there are all grades of martial arts. The superior militarist foils enemies' plots. Next best is to ruin their alliances. Next after that is to attack their armed forces. Worst is to besiege their cities. This ideal strategy whereupon one could win without fighting, accomplish the most by doing the least, bears the characteristic stamp of Taoism, the ancient tradition of knowledge that fostered both the healing arts and the martial arts in China. The ancient Taoist masters showed how the man of aggressive violence appears to be ruthless, but is really an emotionalist. Then they slay the emotionalist with real ruthlessness, before revealing the spontaneous nature of free humanity. Real ruthlessness, the coldness of complete objectivity, always includes oneself in its cutting assessment of the real situation. This is the ruthlessness of Lao Tzu when he says in the Tao Te Ching that the universe is inhumane, and the sage sees people as being like the straw dogs used for ritual sacrifices. Zhuang Tzu, another ancient Taoist master, also gives numerous dramatic illustrations of ruthlessness toward oneself as an exercise in perspective designed to lead to cessation of internal and external conflict. this inhumanity, is not used by the original philosophers as a justification for quasi-ruthless, possessive aggression, but as a meditation on the ultimate meaninglessness of the greed and possessiveness that underlie aggression. In India, Buddhist aspirants used to visit burning grounds and watch the corpses of those whose families couldn't afford a cremation rot away. This they did to terrify the greed and possessiveness out of themselves. After that, they turned their minds toward thoughts of ideal individuals and ideal societies. Similarly, Master Sun has his readers dwell on the ravages of war, from its incipient phases of treachery and alienation to its extreme forms of incendiary attack and siege, viewed as a sort of mass cannibalism of human and natural resources. With this device, he gives the reader an enhanced feeling for the significance of individual and social virtues espoused by the humanitarian pacifists. Paradox is often thought of as a standard device of Taoist psychology, used across imperceptible barriers of awareness. Perhaps the paradox of the art of war is in its opposition to war. And as the art of war wars against war, it does so by its own principles. It infiltrates the enemy's lines, uncovers the enemy's secrets, and changes the hearts of the enemy's troops. The commentary in this translation has been selected from a standard collection of 11 interpreters who lived from the 2nd to the 12th centuries CE. Chapter 1. Strategic Assessments. Military action is important to the nation. It is the ground of death and life, the path of survival and destruction, so it is imperative to examine it. The ground means the location, the place of pitched battle. Gain the advantage and you live. Lose the advantage and you die. Therefore, military action is called the ground of death and life. The path means the way to adjust to the situation and establish victory. Find this and you survive. Lose this and you perish. Therefore, measure in terms of five things. Use these assessments to make comparisons, and thus find out what the conditions are. The five things are the way, the weather, the terrain, the leadership, and discipline. These are to be assessed at headquarters. First, assess yourself and your opponent in terms of these five things, deciding who is superior. Then you can determine who is likely to prevail. The way means inducing people to have the same aim as the leadership, so that they will share death and share life without fear of danger. The way means humaneness and justice. In ancient times, a famous minister of state asked a political philosopher about military matters. The philosopher said, "Humaneness and justice are the means by which to govern properly. When government is carried out properly, people feel close to the leadership and think little of dying for it." The weather means the seasons. In ancient times, many soldiers lost their fingers to frostbite on campaigns against the Huns, and many soldiers died of plague on campaigns against the southern tribes. This was because of carrying out operations in winter or summer. The terrain is to be assessed in terms of distance, difficulty, or ease of travel, dimension, and safety. In any military operation, it is important first to know the lay of the land. When you know the distance to be traveled, then you can plan whether to proceed directly or by a circuitous route. When you know the difficulty or ease of travel, then you can determine the advantages of infantry or mounted troops. When you know the dimensions of the area, then you can assess how many troops you need, many or few. When you know the relative safety of the terrain, then you can discern whether to do battle or disperse. Leadership is a matter of intelligence, trustworthiness, humaneness, courage, and sternness. The way of the ancient kings was to consider humaneness foremost, while the martial artists considered intelligence foremost. This is because intelligence involves ability to plan and to know when to change effectively.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.